Thank you so much, everyone, for joining us for today's webinar, How to Build a Sound Strategy. Today's webinar is being presented in partnership with TURF, and I'm going to be your host, Avi Rajagopal. I'm the editor-in-chief of Metropolis. You know, pre-pandemic, noise was one of the biggest complaints that most designers got for interior spaces, especially in workplaces. And, you know, as the ways that we work, as the ways that we engage with the built environment have shifted around and changed, I think our relationship to sound noise has shifted too. We are currently balancing, virtual experiences, in-person experiences, outdoor experiences that are not always optimized for the best sound. Sound is also something that is, straddles, as all our senses do, the lines between the physiological and the cultural. And so, different folks have different preferences, desires, comfort levels with sound. And we come with a variety of needs and wants when it comes to spaces that really support us. So how do we utilize sound as a tool in creating safe and supportive spaces? That's what we're going to talk about today. And I have a fantastic group of panelists here to join me to talk about that. We have with us Robbie Eliezer, who is the design director at Trahan Architects. Robbie, thanks so much for joining us today. Also with us is Carolyn Ames Noble, who's the founder and director of design at Ames Design Collective. Carolyn, such a pleasure to have you. We have Raj Patel, who is an Arab fellow and the CEO of Acorn Technology Systems. Raj, thank you so much for joining me. And we have also with us Ben Pamlin, who is a former director of inclusive design at Microsoft. And of course, now is working on a variety of design projects. Ben, such a pleasure to have you join us today. Raj, why don't we start with you? At the start of last year, you had a book published, Architectural Acoustics, A Guide to Integrated Thinking. And you've consulted on acoustics with some of the biggest architectural projects in the world. Can you tell us the role that acoustics plays within the broader design strategy for those projects?
Sure, Avi, thanks. I think it should play an important role on every project. But it doesn't, and it hasn't always done so either. I think in the past, many design processes were geared and informed by what we see. Everybody's very used to looking at drawings and more recently renderings and so on. And many people probably mistakenly think that our experience of the built environment is mainly driven by what we see. But actually, our experiences in the built environment are driven by all of our senses. And really good design would engage all of our senses really well in terms of sort of universal design principles. And to be effective, that needs to be thought about from the very beginning of a project. On projects like concert halls or recording studios, it's usually, hopefully, thought out usually before the project has even started. It forms a fundamental part of the brief in thinking about the project itself. But there are many projects where the traditional old-fashioned way of designing, approaching, you employ an architect first, a structural engineer second, then you get around to your mechanical and electrical systems, and then maybe a lighting consultant and an acoustic consultant. That process is still all too common. Sound is obviously really fundamentally important to our health, to our well-being, to our safety, and amongst other things, should be better considered from the outset of doing any design process. The reason for writing the book was it's not a technical book about acoustics, although it has lots of project examples in it. It's really a book about how to design well for sound and how to think about that from the very outset of a project and make it accessible for designers of any type, really, to understand the process. I will say that the one big step change that's occurred over the last few years is that the process called oralization, which is the ability to, it's the oral equivalent of a visualization, the ability to listen to a building before it's built, has become more and more accessible. In my work at Arup, we pioneered that tool 20 years ago and have continued to develop it. And over the next few years, I think it will become more and more prevalent. So the ability to listen to design, I think, is creating a step change in how people think about it and consider it in the early stages of the project. But I think there's a much greater general awareness, as you quite rightly note. People have been stuck at homes. People have been stuck in different places when they've been working during the pandemic. The concept, the impact of how sound really affects you and your environment and how you work every day and everything that you do really is becoming, people are becoming more and more aware of it and more considerate of it in the design process. So we're certainly seeing an uptick in how people are thinking about it. And of course, on the biggest, most prestigious projects, it's thought about from the outset. Big public projects as well, people where there are mass large numbers of people in a particular type of building, from a safety perspective and from a functional perspective, it's thought about. But it should be thought about in everything.
Thank you so much for that introduction, Raj. I think you bring up a couple of things here. First of all, as the title of your book says, it's a guide to integrated thinking. And I think integrating that acoustics right from the start is so important. I think the other thing underlying what you're saying is, how do we make acoustics part of everyday, so to speak, design practice, right? How does it start to inform every project, and how does it start to do that at the beginning of projects? And I'm sure we're going to dive a little deeper into how do we sort of oralize a space, how do we listen to buildings and how do we listen to projects in just a little bit. And Raj, I'm sure we want to hear more about that, because I think that is a concept that is still 20 years later, still new to folks. And so we should talk about that some more, but that's a great introduction. And I see that at least some of you know that we are open for questions throughout today's discussion. Trevor, thank you so much for jumping right in. Everybody follow Trevor's example. The moment you have a thought or a comment or a response to something one of our panelists is saying, or a question that you may have for them, please go ahead and put it in Q&A. Don't lose it. You don't need to wait. And we will start to take your prompts and your questions in just a few minutes here. Robbie, I'd like to come to you next. Raj talked about how acoustics is sometimes an obvious part of projects like, concert halls or, venues. And you worked on a project like that, the Alliance Theatre in Atlanta, where you took a really, innovative approach to the acoustics. Those kinds of projects often tend to be testing ground or tend to generate insights, hopefully, that can start to influence other types of work or other types of projects as well. So I'd love to hear, how you approached the Alliance Theatre project and, how your work on the theatre kind of dovetails with some of your other spaces, cultural spaces, outdoor spaces that Trehan is working on, where sound is obviously such a key part of people's spatial experience.
Thanks, Abby. That's a great question. So the Alliance Theatre was an interesting project because it was a gut renovation, a transformation of an existing theater. The Alliance was not well served by their old space. They hadn't had a meaningful new facility in 50 years. So we really had a kind of a low bar to judge against. But we also had a kind of a cultural society in Atlanta that we were designing in. So, in the days of segregation, many patrons were relegated to the balcony. So we heard painful stories from the community about what that was like to come to shows and not be able to sit in the main audience. And so the first thing that we did on the Alliance Theater was kind of question the role of the balcony in the theater. So it's iconic in that all the circulation occurs in the hall. So instead of having a kind of outer lobby and you pop into a box or pop into a balcony or pop into a parterre, there's this kind of interior promenade of ramps and stairs that are fully within the room. And it kind of cascades between the balcony and the orchestra. So if you're in a private box, you're actually on that shared pathway. You don't take a separate entrance. You don't have a special door. And same thing if you're in, let's say, a more affordable ticket, you take the same route to your seat. So the first thing we did in the Alliance Theater was kind of try to challenge those notions of segregation that existed historically in theaters. And that's where we got the plan and that very iconic cascade that defines the room, that kind of warm embrace. Another thing that we felt really strongly about is kind of inducing a highly concave plan which Raj, I'm sure you would know, caused all kinds of issues with us in terms of sound focusing geometries. So the room's incredibly sound focusing, and it's also a bit wider than you need for a spoken word room because we brought that circulation interior. So we kind of induced in the plan two issues acoustically, extreme concavity and width. And we had to overcome that with the acoustics and with the materiality of the room. So kind of co-evolving from challenging the planning of the room and creating the cascade, we had to embark on a kind of an experimental research project to kind of solve those acoustical phenomenon. I could probably talk for 2 hours on it. I have before, but I'll tell kind of one example of how we kind of overcame those issues. The first thing that Trey Trahan, the founder of our firm, and I said is like, how are we going to build these shapes? They're curvaceous and they're complex. And we didn't want to repeat the mistakes we had done in the past projects where we had, on the Louisiana State Museum, carved thousands of molds and cast stone into them and discarded those molds. So we wanted a system that wasn't very wasteful. And one night, in kind of an epiphany, Trey texted me, have you seen this sculptor, Mateus Plisnik? And I was very familiar with his work. He happens to be in Brooklyn, about 30 minutes from our studio. And so Trey and I showed up at Mateus's office one day and we said, we think the steam bending technique could be used at the scale of the room. I mean, it was that crazy. And so we hired Mateus and we built 13 full-scale mock-ups of various pieces in the room to test how that wood lattice work could solve the geometry problems, but also solve the acoustics. So on the balcony front specifically, we did two things. One, we developed a kind of sinusoidal profile that is swept across the face of the balcony, and it alternates between closed and porous. And so those two features, the sinusoidal geometry and plan and section, and the pattern of solid and void, actually overcomes a lot of the sound reflections from the stage on that highly curved front balcony piece, but all with one material system. All of it is through wood and through the geometry of that shaping. And as that balcony sweeps across, it actually then transitions into an area that's non-performative, just an open lattice millwork. So I think that's the most key thing about the Alliance Theater that I think is so special about it is the millwork is performative in some areas through analysis and shaping. And then others is purely experiential. And it's kind of doing both of those things. It's the finish, it's the tactile experience, and it's that kind of way that we overcame some of those acoustic challenges. And so we learned a lot of lessons about acoustics on the Alliance Theater for sure. But one of our takeaways was, it is kind of fun to collaborate with acousticians when we do things that are antithetical that we know are going to cause issues that are going to force us to innovate. So I'll tell two quick project stories that are lessons learned. One, we're doing a little amphitheater in Arkansas for Luther George Park. Lead landscape architects are Spackman Mossett Michaels, and it's for the Walton Family Foundation. So they had a really simple brief, make a kind of iconic sculptural pavilion that could be dual functional. And we had this crazy idea that can maybe be two-sided and host movies off one side and concerts off the other. So it's kind of an open air pavilion with no backstage house. It's almost like a picture frame in the landscape. But we wanted it to be like a rolling hill in the garden, to kind of pick up on the forms of the park. And so as we were doing the analysis, we had this very tall, deeply concave shape, and we were working with threshold acoustics, and they did a bunch of really beautiful animations for us that showed that the shape was really working against us in the AV sound system. And we were also up against a massive VE on the project. And so I called Robin Glostermeyer, partner there, and said, how are we gonna fix this? And she said, well, I have an idea, which is your shape's really bad and you're over budget. So she sent me a sketch of kind of flattening out some of the curvature, but in a very specific way. And I regenerated the whole design, we retested it, and voila, we kind of solved the acoustics with that and cut the steel area in almost half. So that was a really beautiful example of how partnering with an acoustician, you can not only make the project sound great, but you can sometimes achieve your budget, and kind of solve other problems too. And the last story I'll tell is we're working on a chapel in New Orleans, And it's a spoken word chapel for the Jesuit community down there. It's a pretty small room, maybe 200 seats. And so all the lessons we learned about equity on the Alliance Theater, we kind of took to the extreme on this project. Every room is a circle. And so it's these series of drums and plan that interlock and work together. And the acoustics are really challenging in a circular room. And so not in a similar way, we've kind of impregnating the project with this very antithetical geometry, the circle, which doesn't want to work for spoken word acoustics, but we're solving it with other ways. So we're exploring 3D printing the interior surfaces of that room with a set of scallop patterns that create a highly diffusive pattern, but it's incredibly beautiful. And it augments the architecture, it augments the embrace of the circle, and it's differential based on where we need the relief and where we don't. As it goes up the walls, it kind of opens up like a sponge and becomes more absorptive. So these stories are really fun because there are threads between the projects. We often start with that big idea about bringing people together and acknowledge the problems we're about to cause with things like acoustics, but we bring our acousticians in very early and we partner with them and they challenge us and we try to integrate their ideas early on. And in the end result is projects that perform really, really well for acoustics, which ultimately makes people feel like they belong in a space. There's nothing more disorienting than going to a space where you don't feel like you belong, and acoustics are a huge part of that.
Thank you so much for that, Robbie. It's really wonderful how you know, the acoustic strategy is so integrated into the very fabric of the space, and how, you know, in all three cases, in the Alliance Theater, in the park project, as well as the chapel, it sounds like, you know, material solutions were such a big part of that, and really pushing forward in terms of material capabilities was so important to, you know, achieving some of that acoustic performance. And I think that's a really, you said it, you know, often paying attention to acoustics can result in sort of, you know, multiplying benefits across a project, maybe even in terms of budget. And so, looking at acoustics as you know, one factor within all of the other factors in the project, but early, as Raj pointed out, is really, really important. I also love that in all three projects, it seems like the acoustic strategy really was so tied to the values of the project, which were essentially about equity and openness and inclusion. And you brought that up right at the end. You know, it's so important. And thinking about sound as a tool to create an equitable and a good experience for everyone who encounters the places we design is absolutely key, which is a cue for Ben. Ben, you know, can you tell us about, you know, your work with inclusive design at Microsoft, and particularly what role has sound played within that? Now, you know, often, of course, you know, you're looking at virtual spaces as much as you're looking at physical experience. And I think some of your experience in that area especially is important as we try and bridge those experiences now, you know, in a COVID-informed world. Yeah. So how do we look at sound, and how can we leverage sound when we want to be accessible and inclusive with our work?
We think of sound in the same way we think about any other mechanism of input. Like, we have the luxury of being able to use keyboards. We have the luxury of being able to use our voice. We have the luxury of having a variety of different tools in which to be able to interact with computers. And one of the questions that we, and I to this day, I still think it's one of the most important questions you can ask in any design project. And it's important to ask it, not just at the beginning, but throughout the life cycle of the design project, which is, who are we unintentionally excluding from participating? Because one of the things you begin to realize is that no matter how great a designer you are, no matter what your medium for design is, there is always someone that is unintentionally excluded. It's just, it's part of this notion of, I will always design a set of products or a set of services or solutions that are largely based on my lived experience. And so the role of designing products, whether it be acoustic products, whether it be other forms of input, is really about ensuring that the people that you've got in the room providing you with input feel like they're a perfect diverse representation of the customers that you aim to serve, and not necessarily the people that designed it. So that becomes really important. And I mean, just to give you a really super quick example, you know, I think COVID has provided, you know, frankly, a pretty fascinating example, and it's helped us. I think it's helped us recognize that there are a lot of product and service gaps in a lot of the products we have. I mean, if you just take something really simple that we do every single day, like meetings, you know, all of a sudden everyone's now, especially if you're working in an information-based business, everyone is sent home and they're now working from home. And this, in essence, becomes the meeting room. And when everyone's dialing into the meeting, it actually forces all of us actually to communicate very, very differently. And it also forces us, perhaps more importantly, to listen differently as well. You know, on one hand, we're able to, I think, kind of almost deconstruct this sort of in-room, out-room dynamic that exists when you've got a bunch of people that have historically joined a meeting from a conference room and the people that are then joining from home. Often the people that are joining remotely tend to be passively involved in that meeting. And now all of a sudden you're creating equity because of what's happened with a global pandemic that allows everyone to feel like they're actually now on a relatively level playing field. But again, you know, I go back to this question, you know, who is unintentionally excluded from participating in these kinds of meetings? And when you think about someone who's deaf as an example, the simple cognitive load that comes from listening and communicating in new ways has created new challenges for all of us. You know, we often talk about this idea of Zoom fatigue, right? But for people with disabilities, people who are deaf in particular, those challenges are even more acute. But in essence, what we're doing is we sort of think about design, whether it be for acoustics or any other dimension of building products for a relatively diverse group of people. It's about, in essence, mismatching or identifying where those human interactions are being mismatched. And it can be done from a variety of different places, whether it's from your ability to touch, your ability to be able to see, the ability to be able to hear, the ability to be able to speak. And increasingly, I think, as we've gone through this pandemic, the ability to be able to feel, you know, the role of mental health as we sort of think about building products that are genuinely inclusive, I think becomes really important too. So that question, and that question asked many, many times over throughout that design process, who am I unintentionally excluding, ends up becoming an incredible question, not just to ensure that we're building inclusive products, but it, more importantly, it actually opens up or unlocks an opportunity to innovate in ways that we perhaps didn't see.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, we often, as designers, talk about user-centered design. We talk about user experience. But of course, all of those, the validity of any of those concepts depends on how one defines users. Right. And, you know, the moment you're starting to define groups, of course, you're including and excluding. And I love what you said, Ben, about, you know, asking.
I will say that there's only two industries in the world that talk about users, and that's technology and drug dealers. They tend to be people, and I think we've got to continually remind ourselves that these are real people. They're not actually users.
Absolutely. You know, and that's the thing, right? It's also what is our mindset when we think about, you know, when we're talking about interior design, we often talk about occupants, when we talk about architecture, you know, and again, you know, that can be a term that is both, you know, can be as inclusive or as exclusive, you know, because we're often trying to define that first as we start to define spaces. And in that very act, we've set up some barriers. And I think, you know, talking about sound as part of that is really important. You know, again, within design, we tend to privilege the visual senses, whether that's in, you know, graphic design or in, you know, or it's in interior design or in architecture. And, you know, starting to think about access, not just in terms of visuals or in terms of mobility, but also in terms of sound, is really important. And we'll dig a little bit further into how do we look at different auditory needs and how do we look at sort of overstimulation and understimulation in just a few minutes here. But thank you so much for that, Ben. Carolyn, I'd love to bring you in hot on the heels of that. You know, we've talked about acoustics being an integrated or integral part of the design process and why that's important. We've talked about the advantages that can offer, but also that it allows us to use acoustics as a tool for inclusivity. And Ben has spoken about, you know, how do we create equitable experiences and how do we look at sound as part of that? Your own work, some of your research, at least from recent times, has focused on the connections between sound and other sensory elements in space, like color, for example, and how we leverage those to create spaces that are healthy and supportive. Can you talk about some of those connections? Can you talk about your more recent research work and how do we place sound among all the other things we might consider as interior designers?
Yes, thank you so much, Avi. Thanks for having me today. To your point, I've been involved with extensive research with TURF design, and TURF, of course, creates acoustic products. But what is so interesting about this team is they're really interested in the environmental design. They're really interested in the health and the well-being attributes. And you know, we all have had our own experiences through this pandemic. Ben, by the way, I really appreciate what you shared about Zoom. As a working mother, a lot of us have actually felt like we've had a larger voice and a seat at the table through this on-screen platform. So I appreciate you bringing that up. Another thing that we realized through our experience, again, working with TURF, we had this experience that was so digital, and we started to wonder when we would re-engage our spaces, what that might feel like. And that's when we really started to go down this path of sensory design discovery, thinking about the integration of our senses. For example, we often think of smell and taste. It would be really challenging to really enjoy that meal with only one or the other. And so when you think about sensory integration in our spaces, that are very primarily sight-driven, when we start to unlock and provide sensory discovery for all individuals, you start to really include everyone. For example, we all process our senses differently. We all integrate our senses differently. As designers, there is no way we'll be able to help somebody's sensory integration. But what we can do is take away the barriers that might block it. Example, I think color and sound is really interesting because you would think to yourself, how are those two things connected? I see Ben nodding his head enthusiastically. Mm-hmm. They are so interconnected. When you think of perhaps somebody who might be hyposensitive and really needs maybe a more calm current, maybe sound that has increased NRC. So Well Building Institute, just providing some real-time strategies, they look at a 0.7 in those spaces. So 70% of that sound is getting absorbed. So you have that really nice distilled sound, and color can really support that as well. Think about a soft, diffuse grade blue, for example, and how calming and also creative that color can be. Conversely, maybe you're someone that's hypersensitive and you actually need that stimulation. You're the person that needs that extra cup of coffee in the morning. And perhaps you're an individual that actually really starts to, you know, crave music and sound, and bold color can do that same sort of stimulation. So when they're used together, and then you thread in something like smell. So think about smell from a product standpoint, eliminating the VOCs makes sense. When you think about tactility, Robbie's example of the wood was so just fitting. You know, thinking of wood look textures and the way that can also feel very biophilic. Now you're starting to thread across the senses and you're helping support someone's experience in a space. And what I find so interesting about this research about sensorial design, it really does start to have and again, I appreciate what Ben said about unintentionally leaving someone out. But we found in this discovery that maybe we're bringing more people into our conversation. I think back to ADA. ADA, of course, it was in 1990, and you started the grab bar, for example. The grab bar, how many of you use the grab bar whenever you're in a public space? I know I do. While that made somebody's ability and their opportunity in the space more equitable, what it did is it actually elevated the design for all of us. So when I see sensory design in our spaces and thinking about acoustic comfort or a color palette or providing user choice in the way we engage and use our spaces, I think that we're actually enhancing the design for everyone.
Absolutely, Carolyn. And you know, that's, I think, the dream of, Raj started us off talking about universal design principles. I think that's the dream, is that, you know, that we'll be able to in including people, in intentionally including, as opposed to unintentionally excluding, that we might have some of those multiplying benefits, some of those benefits that are, you know, kind of hidden, unintended, you know, for all of us. And I think that's really the hope here. I also really love what you said about using sound in conjunction with other elements, color, materiality, and so on. And we'll dig a little deeper into that. Maybe we should just take a couple of the questions here from our audience. And folks, if you have any other comments or questions, please go ahead and put them in and start to talk about how do we prototype, how do we test currently acoustic solutions. Robbie, you spoke a little bit about this. Raj, you were talking about the oralization concept. Maybe Raj, you want to start us off talking about, you know, what are some best practices now in terms of testing for acoustics? And, you know, how can it become more integrated into the design process as a, you know, as part of our prototyping, as part of, you know, our visualization, our model making processes?
Sure, I'll have a go at that. I mean, the basic starting point should always be the same, that the fundamental understanding that a room shape, its form, its volume, and its materials are the things that fundamentally affect how it's going to sound, right? It's so you have to know and understand that from the beginning. So the first step in the analysis is, what do I want to do in a space? Who am I doing it for? And therefore, what are the right conditions to be able to deliver that to the people who are going to experience that space? And all too often, the starting points are usually wrong. That's where the first thing happens, that somebody decides the room is going to be 20 feet tall, when really, from an acoustic standpoint, only needs to be 10 feet tall. So real sort of starting with the basic fundamentals. And that empirical knowledge, any good acoustic consultant knows the answer to those questions. And in fact, they're pretty easy to find on the web too. So doing that, thinking about that first is important. The next step beyond that then is, when you're working closely in a design team situation, you can take those principles and you start to expand them. So you start to think, as Ben kind of touched on, what do you want people to feel? Why do you want them to feel it the way that you want them to feel it? Who's it for? And listening to speech is very different to listening to rock music, and that in turn is very different to listening to classical music. And it's very different to working in a room with 100 other people trying to all perform slightly different tasks, right? So you really need to understand the subject matter in detail in order to be able to design the right conditions. The next step, I would say, the next step in our process usually is, having done that sort of the very basic work, then you start to think about, and of course you want to push the boundaries around shape, you know, shape, form, volume, materials. Those things don't need to be static. You don't want them to be static. You want spaces to be unique. So the next step is, how do I start to analyze those things? And there are two-dimensional tools that allow you to have a look at how sound reflections are behaving in rooms. So again, some of those are becoming more prevalent on the web. And for plugins for programs like Rhino. The next step is to be able to analyze it in 3D. Firstly, just visually. So there are some pieces of computer analysis that you can do that allow you to look at sound from a particular source, see how it propagates in a room, and be able to make some changes to understand how the shape and form, the macro level shape and form, is affecting what's happening. The third step after that then is to go to an acoustic computer model, usually, to put the the space in, to put the materials in, to put their properties in, how much sound they absorb, how much they diffuse, how much they reflect, and then use that as your next step of analysis. And usually each of these tools is kind of geared to a stage in the design process, right? So in an ideal world, what you're doing is using the right tool for the right job at the right time in that process and evolving as you go through it. And the great thing about the tools is they allow you to do two things, especially when you get to the point where you're starting to listen to things with your clients. And I would say that we actually start listening to projects with our clients very early on now, concept design and schematic design. Once you start to do that, you engage your clients, so they understand the implications of sound. So they experience it firsthand and they start to say, okay, I like that and I don't like that. I find that pleasant, I find that disturbing. They become very, very simple things to deal with. If you get it right then, your client's always going to say in value engineering later on, but if I take that out, is it going to sound bad? Is it going to sound like that poor example I heard early on? So it allows you to maintain the right things during the design process. It allows you to engage a broader community as well. So if you're doing a project in the urban environment and it has traffic noise or it has other noise, or you can allow people to experience those and understand what the impact of taking or adding sounds in to an environment can be. And then somebody mentioned biophilic sounds earlier on. You know, there are sounds in nature that we generally find, most of us find pleasant. Sounds of flowing water, the sound of wind in the trees, the sound of waves lapping on a beach, those sorts of sounds, the sounds of birdsong. These are natural things that we're used to. Sometimes you can introduce. Yeah, indeed. And you can start to introduce those sounds in order to be able to improve how an environment sounds when you have a challenging situation that you can't negate through the design alone. So thinking about all of those things holistically can lead you to the right solution, but it does require the right thinking from the outset.
Yeah, I love the idea of getting the clients involved, you know, and putting sound in their minds as a criterion for success or failure for any element of the project. That's so key. And, you know, I know that's just one small part of all the things that you just spoke about, Raj, but I think we have a related question. So I just wanted to emphasize that. I think that's really key there. Anybody else in terms of, you know, how can we sort of prototype acoustics? I know, Robbie, of course, you work with a consultant on some of your projects. Maybe we want to talk about that. Carolyn, in an interior scale, any suggestions there?
Yes, Raj, really, really great answer on so many threads. I think you saw my excitement when you were talking about even acoustic ecology and that idea that it's really the same type of physiological response on our body, similar to biophilic design, just hearing those natural sounds. And I wanted to also say, thinking about the schematic design, so from an interior designer's perspective, when you think about the sound zone map, it's really quite, I mean, they really can be so harmonious. When you have a collaborative space that perhaps is more engaging, conversational, versus maybe it's a space for quiet or heads down or contemplation, meditation. It's just amazing how when you really start to think about the way your space plan can really outline with the sound zone map, you'll already start with a really great strategy in the very beginning, even before you specify one product and get to the materiality part of it. So Raj, that was a really great point and something that interior designers can definitely take and action in projects. Yeah.
Yeah, I think I want to build on what Raj was saying earlier and Carolyn. I think integrating acoustics in the process early is becoming a best practice, in my opinion. And all kinds of spaces benefit from that input. Even an office space early on, understanding the background noise levels of your HVAC system and how that's going to affect the room acoustics is critical because, you know, in those early stages when you're making critical decisions like systems choice, you have to understand the implication of those decisions. And without acoustical input, I think you can, you know, even in those early phases, narratives, you know, early DD, you can go down the wrong path if that input's not in early. And then I think too, what's great about having experts is just like architecture, you know, I'm able to process far more nuance in architectural design than my clients are. And acousticians are able to hold far more nuance in acoustical design than architects are. And so on down the lane with all the experts. And so a good example of this is, you know, I'm constantly being educated in the process by acquisitions about things like, you know, how did our hearing system evolve, right? We were born to be in the woods and be surrounded by a myriad of surfaces at different elevations and of different material qualities. And so our ears are really adept at hearing sounds in that kind of environment. And so when we make really sterile architecture with blank, smooth surfaces that go on endlessly, you may actually have the right NRC, you may actually have the right absorption, and it may be in the right places, but the kind of tactility of the acoustics becomes really important. Is it ringing? Is the high pitch too high? Are we isolating correctly? So all of these things end up really mattering, even in the early decisions. Program adjacency is critical. You know, understanding where we're going to have a noisy mechanical room. So all of that input, I think, is critical to the beginning. And in terms of prototyping, I agree with Raj, testing things and testing early is really critical. And doing so in computer and simulation environments is becoming more and more normal in our processes. I'm still pretty bad at some of the plugins, but I find the video is really helpful when we review them with our acoustician, and the sound rooms are critical too, so we can start to get the look and feel. So those processes, I echo what Raj is saying, are critical in the early stages, and they can set the course of a project rather than doing things in the later stages when you're less malleable to react. And then Abby, you asked a question about prototyping acoustics, and I think this is a great one. You know, we do a lot of things like just getting material samples and sending them to our acoustician. So that can be a really simple way of integrating into your process. It doesn't have to all be very fancy, but getting the right fabric that's going to go to the air machine, you can see how much air gets through, which is a really quick test. We do those things all the time. And so I think mocking up and prototyping and sending those things to your acoustician are critical. On the Alliance, we sent chunks of the wall paneling and the mock-ups from Mateus to the acoustician so that we could fold that into the process. And one of the things that came out of that is something that we didn't really quite realize, which is the wood system was much stiffer than the early analysis models assumed. But the physical testing showed us that the surface was quite stiff. And so we changed the analysis models in response to what the physical mockups showed us, which was really surprising for everyone. And it really helped the acoustics in the end.
That's awesome. Yeah, so find the plugins, sound zones, get materials tested. And then Carolyn threw out noise, the noise reduction coefficient. So learning some of those very basic sort of information that, you know, even like acoustic panel providers and others will give you that data on some of their products. So, you know, there's ways for to gather the input, especially on simpler projects. We have a couple of questions here that link together. And I'd love to get a response on this because I think it's a good entryway for a lot of folks who might be listening in. And Ben, we might actually start with you on this, even though we know you're looking more at digital experiences maybe than physical spaces. Trevor says, when a project is focused on solution for acoustic use, it gives a lot of leeway to the strategy for design. However, how do we help everyday projects understand and see the importance of sound and the benefits of an acoustic strategy? And then we have a link question. Shelley says, please share an experience you've had where you've successfully persuaded a client to pay attention to sound and acoustics. Thank you. So can we talk about any actual projects or situations where a stakeholder suddenly realized the importance of sound or where it made a big difference? Ben, if you'd like to start and everybody else start thinking of maybe a favorite story of yours about acoustics.
So I'll share a really quick story and then I'll sort of leave you with both a story and an opportunity because there's a piece of work that I've been dying to do for a long time. And I'm pretty sure that the people on the call and on this panel are probably the kind of people that could actually make this a reality. So, having worked at Microsoft for 16 years, we have the luxury of some pretty highly amazing equipment to the point we have an entire acoustic lab at Microsoft. In fact, we actually have an anechoic chamber That sits in one of our buildings on campus in Redmond, Washington. So much so that we actually got this anechoic chamber tested just a few years ago, and it was actually awarded the Guinness Book of World Records for being the quietest place on Earth. It was around about minus 26 dBA, which is almost as close to what's referred to as Brownian motion as possible, which is kind of crazy. And the reason for doing that, the reason for investing in that kind of technology is to improve everything from the way in which your voice interacts with computers to the way we begin to start to design specific pieces of hardware, to how we think about creating a set of software-generated voice-based algorithms. And so, you know, it's a core part of our both hardware, software, and service design efforts. The second story I'll share with you, and I kind of want to pick up on something that Carolyn talked about before, this idea of kind of creating a set of multi-sensory experiences. I had the opportunity a few years ago to sit down with a recording artist by the name of Mandy Harvey. Some of you may have heard of her. I think she was a finalist on America's Got Talent maybe 4 or 5 years ago. Anyway, to cut a long story short, she was diagnosed as being deaf at around about the age of 17 or 18. And she just happened to be at Microsoft one particular day, and someone had asked me to sort of spend a couple of hours with her, showing around and showing her some of the interesting technology that we use at Microsoft. And I was specifically showing her a piece of technology called HoloLens, which is some of the work that Microsoft's done around augmented reality or mixed reality. And she asked this really interesting question, which was, you know, as a deaf performer, she said, "Have you got a sense of what you think the color of music looks like?" And it was a relatively abstract question, so obviously I was curious and asked more. And she says, "Look, you know, as a deaf performer, I'm very, very mindful that the experience of my concert when I'm performing live is not a particularly multi-sensory experience for someone that is deaf. But I'm convinced that there's a really interesting way that technology can help begin to start to bridge that gap." She sort of said, "Look, you know, right now you can come into my concert and you can probably take something like a mobile phone and you can read a set of closed captionings which give you a sense of the lyrics, and you can feel the music as it's reverberating around the stadium. But wouldn't it be interesting if, you know, I sung a particularly high note, you could actually match that with a particular color? Or if someone plays a particularly earthy riff on a bass guitar, what's the color that you would associate with that particular note?" And I said, "Look, you know, I think there's technology. I think we could, in essence, build a set of, you know, machine learning algorithms that would allow us to take, you know, every single note and look at every single instrument that's played and, in essence, map a particular color to the way that particular instrument's played. And in essence, the experience that you would have for someone who is, let's say, deaf is not only could you visualize the concert, not only could you feel the music, but as each of those notes are played, you see these wonderful pops of color come up along with the closed captions at the bottom to create this incredibly immersive experience." And, you know, like a lot of inclusive design projects, you kind of look at something like that and there's no doubt it's going to have huge impact and benefit for someone who is deaf. But it's also going to have a huge amount of impact for anyone, because I just think it creates this multi-sensory experience that allows us to just get closer to the performer and really feel the experience of that concert. So I've been chatting with this performer for a long time. I think there's incredible potential there. It's really just a case of identifying how we can begin to start to build the model and how we would potentially leverage some incredible acoustic engineers to be able to make that a reality. So as I said, I kind of label that both an interesting story and at the same time an opportunity to do some really kind of cool work.
I'd be happy to jump in with some project examples. Ben, we are going to have to talk offline because I have a group that we're getting together in the beginning of next year at some point. We've got a whole smattering of color and scientists and musicians that are interested in that exact same topic. So offline, we have to connect.
Love that.
Yes, but I did want to mention, just from the product and materiality standpoint, a couple of really exciting projects that I'm a collaborator at Turf Design, and we are working on this idea. So really threading in a lot of what we said today, including, I also want to make sure, you know, while we're talking about the ideal project and planning at the beginning, we also know we have a lot of retrofits. We understand that. And a few just kind of threads on the product story is this idea that maybe a product isn't just a static NRC. What if we had a product that can be dimensional and even work with a flat product? And so when you're actually thinking about the entire environment, similar to being in nature, where there's that little bit of an ebb and flow and a reflection and absorption of sound that feels more natural for all of us in a space. So that's a project we're currently working on. Little teaser here, you'll know more this month. And another really exciting project that we have been working on for over 18 months is a brand new color system where we have really focused on sensory design and how that will be as far as color, with this hypothesis that a palette can actually take you through an entire space, creating those lifts and those moments for someone who might be hypersensitive to those moments of calm and tranquility, for somebody that might be hyposensitive, and all levels in between. So this idea that a palette can be harmonious with colors, something that we're currently working on and arriving at. It's been a really rewarding process, and we're just so thrilled that we're getting there on it.
Maybe Avi, I'll just jump in and say it, that any client who has gone through the process of designing a building and has had major acoustic problems never tries to have them again. Right? So the awareness of what happens when it goes wrong is a big thing in changing people's attitudes towards how it's incorporated into the design process. The unfortunate thing is there are many clients who only ever build a building once. And it's a shame that for them, they don't have the opportunity to make sure it's done right. And they don't have professionals who are telling them that there's an opportunity to design it right. So I would say, don't wing it. You know, if you can find a good acoustic consultant, have them, even if you only have them consult at the very beginning of a project and not follow that through, they're going to set you in the right direction at the very beginning. And in some cases, projects can't always afford that, but do what you can and try and get an expert opinion early that will point you in the right direction. I'll also say that any client who's gone through the process of using a tool like the Arup Sound Lab, once they've experienced that, they never want to do a design without it, because it enriches the entire process for them and helps them understand the outcome, what they're going to get, much, much earlier in the design process than they otherwise would. So I'd point people to the Arup website. If you just look up Sound Lab, there are some good examples there of work that's been done using that, and good examples that you can show people.
Robbie, any aha moments with clients?
Any aha moments with clients? Yes, I mean, I think there's always those moments of discovery on projects where what the professionals have in their head finally resonates with your group that you're working with. Trying to think of a really specific example on the chapel project. You know, all these rooms were circular, and at one point they were domed, and they were kind of intersecting. And we really intuitively understood what was happening, but they were really struggling with it. And we did a 3D print that was clear, and they could finally see those spaces. And I remember the aha moment. They were like, "Oh, it's a cylinder," and we're like, "Yes." I know that seems kind of simple sometimes, but sometimes the relationship between our drawings and our designs can be lost. So. That was a cool moment. And the specific cylinder was shaped by the acoustics. It had a kind of blunted top. So the whole ceiling was this beautiful reflector, but it was hard for them to understand that geometry. So that was a cool moment.
Avi, perhaps I'd say one more thing, which is, in the absence of all of the tools and all of the, you know, the more sophisticated stuff we've talked about here, I've also found that the most essential thing to do with a client at the beginning of a project is ask them about spaces they like the sound of, and that they don't like the sound of and they have problems with, and actually go together and listen to them and understand what they like and don't like about them. And I often encourage architects to, when they do that, to do it with their eyes closed, because then they get a better impression Well, rather than thinking with their eyes, they start to think with their ears. And it's good actually for the whole design team to do that. Think about experiencing the environment by blocking off one of your senses and see what you find different about it. And it really creates fundamental shifts in the way that you think about the built environment when you do that.
Yeah. I think we should just adopt thinking with your ears as a motto for this discussion. That's really vital. Thank you so much for that, Raj. This idea that, you know, just as we would, you know, ask clients for references on the kinds of spaces they like, the kinds of materials they like, what resonates with them, you know, on materiality or color or experience, it's really important to ask them on sound as well. So that's like an easy first step. Thank you so much for that. We've gone through a lot of different things today, and I just want to make an attempt at sort of threading them together. It's clear that acoustics needs to be part of, you know, early stage thinking in projects. And as Raj said, even before any software or tools or experts or acousticians come into the process, just making sure that you're thinking with your ears is really important. And knowing that that has a vital impact on the human experience of whatever it is that you're designing, whether it's a interior, a building, a physical space, or a digital space. I think all of those, you know, all of those are really impacted by how we hear. And so that's really important. There are plugins and tools that you can use through your design process to look at that. Acousticians or acoustic consultants are really important partners on this process. So that's another big takeaway as part of this. And then of course, knowing that handling acoustics can have benefits beyond just the, you know, auditory experience of a space, that good acoustics can help really elevate space, but can also, in the hands of a good acoustician or within a good design strategy, provide benefits that might be, you know, for budget, for climate, for health, you know, for all sorts of other things. So really thinking about acoustics as a tool in a toolkit, you know, on all of those fronts is really important. Ben, thank you so much for bringing in the idea of, you know, unintentionally excluding people. And I think also for that last really beautiful thought you had about, you know, crossing senses, thinking about how senses kind of overlap with one another and how we can really create those layered multisensory experiences. So building on what Carolyn said, you know, think about sound alongside color, materiality, alongside sort of spatial perception, spatial zones, you know, all the things that we think about as designers, and know that there is some exciting work on the frontiers of those things that can prove to be really beneficial to include, you know, all kinds of users. And that last idea of inclusion, I think, has really threaded through our discussion today. You know, when we're talking about sound in a space, we have to understand not everybody hears the same, not everybody prefers the same kind of sound, and that sound and the ability to hear or participate has also been historically used as a barrier. Robbie, you started us off thinking about segregated spaces, and yet, you know, many spaces are segregated in that sense, right? So if you think about even as we were talking about, you know, a conference room, you know, who sits where at a table and how audible they are to others at the table, right? So there's many barriers that we've put up, and sound has unfortunately been used as a way of dividing. And, you know, we have to think about how we can use sound as a way of including, you know, which is not to say that, you know, all spaces should be auditorily accessible to everyone. You know, walls exist for a reason, but I think the idea is that we are intentional about including people within spaces, not unintentionally excluding people, as Ben put it. Thank you all so much for today's discussion. I really appreciate all the time you've spent with us. Thank you so much for everyone in the audience for listening to us today. It's been a fantastic conversation. If, as we said, today's session is CU accredited, so please reach out if you've not already about that. Metropolis's programs continue with a think tank discussion this Thursday. So if you haven't registered for that, please do so. You can, of course, I urge you to look at Arup's work, especially the Sound Lab. to look at Drehan Architects projects, to look into some of the work that Carolyn has been doing with turf design on the connections between sound, and of course, look out for those new products that are coming out. And of course, Ben's team at Microsoft has produced some excellent guides around accessible design and inclusive design. They're easily accessible through the Microsoft website. So please take a look at that. I do hope that all of that will inspire you to think with your ears. I'm going to steal that from Raj again. Thank you so much for that. Just one last call for all of you who are in the interior design profession, work with interior designers, are in product manufacturing and work with interior designers. Please consider taking the Interior Design Pledge for Positive Impact. It is the first comprehensive framework for sustainability in interior design that unites concerns around climate, health, and equity. And of course, sound is one of the things we do have to think about when you think about health and equity. So please go ahead, sign the pledge, take the pledge, and join us. Signatories of the pledge will receive resources and tools and guidance over the next year in order to understand how they can start moving towards meeting the commitments of the pledge. So please go ahead and take that. It is the first most important tool we have as interior designers to start to make a positive impact with our work. For everybody else, thank you also so much for joining us. And I hope all of you have a great evening.